Funding for this program is brought to you in part by Crowning Touch Senior Moving Services.
Thanks for joining us. I'm Rose Martin, and this is Real Life with Susan Harf, our favorite life coach who offers us tips and strategies to navigate those tricky situations we get ourselves into in everyday life. Like you, I can't wait to hear what's on her mind today. Hi, Susan.
Hi, Rose. I'm happy to see you, and I'm so happy that you joined us as well. So today the question is, should you give advice to your adult children?
Did my mother call you?
The answer is no. Okay, Rose, we're done. We're leaving the set. That's what my children would expect me to want to say. No, that's the answer. That's not the answer, though. That's not it. I think it's important to think about a lot of things when you are approaching giving advice to your adult children. And this is one of those situations. You know, I always say that you don't have to jump off a bridge to know how it feels as a therapist or as a coach. You don't have to have surmounted every problem or every issue that your clients face. But this is one of those situations that it does help to be the mother of adult children to answer this question. Because I've lived it, I have I've lived that with them through their various stages and ages. And what I'm really talking about here is, should you give advice to your adult children? So the first thing that we need to think about is, what prompts you to want to give that advice? And the reason we need to ask that question to ourselves is because we are sending a message to the adult child when we give advice that sometimes we don't even know we're doing. When we give advice, the person could be assuming that we believe they need our advice.
Mm-hmm.
And one step beyond that, we might believe that they're not gonna figure this out without our advice.
And the person might think, mom doesn't think I can do anything, and here they are again, mom or dad.
And that is where it goes, is the adult child may believe, they obviously don't think that I know what I'm doing, because if they did believe I knew what I was doing, they wouldn't be offering me the advice. When in fact, if we stop to consider why are we giving this advice, then we also may offer the reason to the adult child. And you know what the reason is most often when we give advice?
No.
Well, the reason is fear. And it's not even fear for them, although that could be part of it sometimes. It's our own fear.
That they're not going to need you anymore?
That could be part of the fear, that they're not going to need us anymore. Or it could be the anxiety that we experience when we watch someone we love grappling with an issue or dealing with a problem or trying to surmount the next step or whatever it is. Sometimes we feel anxious, and anxiety promotes all kinds of thoughts, feelings, and behaviors. So when we're anxious, we may tend to clam up, but in the case of the parent with the adult child, we tend to talk. We tend to talk more than we should. And so sometimes we end up giving advice when, in fact, it has nothing to do with believing that the child can't do it on their own. We may believe they absolutely can do it on their own, but I'm anxious, so I'm going to talk.
What about if you've conditioned them because of giving them so much advice, they don't even try to offer suggestions. They're just going to kind of sit back and say, well, you're going to tell me which way that this should go, so then it's almost counterproductive that they're not making decisions or doing things on their own because you're always telling them before they can even think about it.
That's exactly right. And we're gonna talk about that in a couple minutes here, because that's another part of this issue, is what prompts the adult child then to seek your advice, to ask for your advice, to take your advice, to not take it. There's all kinds of other dynamics occurring in the advice-giving process. But let's say, for instance, you're offering advice. You find yourself in a situation where you're offering advice.
Solicited or unsolicited, or does it matter?
It matters a lot. Unsolicited
okay.
advice. And let's say the child is thinking, there they go again. They don't think I can handle it. If the child says that to you, that's a bonus. If the child says, do you think I haven't figured it out for myself, or do you think that I haven't been alive, 40 years or 30 years or whatever, that I can't figure this out for myself? If the adult child lets you know in some way that they believe that you think that they can't do it, they can't surmount this, then the reason it's a bonus is you can address that. So I'm going to suggest, even if they don't say that to you, address that. Because they may
sense.
Be thinking it. Mm-hmm. So one of the things that I've said is, oh really? You thought that I believe that you didn't have the answer? Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Well, no, that wasn't it at all. I'm not thinking that at all. I think you can figure it out. Well, Mom, then why did you give me advice? Because you just happen to be the only thing that matters to me. And I need to give you advice because I need to make sure you're good. I need to make sure you're okay. It's my anxiety. It's my need right now. Mm-hmm. It's not about your need. It's my need. You haven't told me that you need my advice. Unsolicited advice is exactly that. They haven't told you that they need you, but you need them at that moment. What do you need them for? Like you said earlier, maybe you need them to need you, but you also need to express to them how important their life matters to you.
Hmm.
And that's usually the need for me, is the last thing on my mind with the two sons I have, the last thing on my mind is that they can't figure it out. That is never in my mind. In fact, another conversation that we should have here is what happens when your children become your confidants and friends, because that's also a beautiful, wonderful evolution in the relationship between a parent and an adult child that I wish for everyone to be able to experience. But getting back to when you're giving the unsolicited advice, you're not thinking necessarily that they can't figure it out. And so the opportunity to tell them that is important. Give yourself that opportunity. If they don't say to you, here you go again, if they just are silent and they listen, if they're that kind to you, then you can say to them, by the way, I don't believe that you're not going to figure this out, but I kind of just need to tell you because I care about you so much and I want the world to be good for you. I want happiness for you. I want you to move through this quick.
So what about if they open the conversation with, you know what I would do, or if I was you, opening up that way, to then you're going to eye roll and say, well, I didn't ask you and you're not me, but okay, let's let it roll. And then you kind of are like, so what do you think, right? And it's awkward then to say, well, I don't think, Mom, I really want your advice, but.
Yeah, and that's an opening for that to happen. So instead of saying that, instead of doing that, what you can say is, I'm thinking about something that might help. Would you like to hear it? So I'm thinking about something that might help is not the same thing as what you should do is.
Right, or if I was you, this is what I would do.
Exactly. So that's something that you can say. The other thing that you can say is, are you interested in what I think? Because sometimes I know that I tell my friends things that, and my spouse things that I don't necessarily want fixed. I'm not asking you to fix it.
Mm-hmm.
I just want you to let me tell you. I just want to tell you.
I'm lucky because my mom will tend to drill down, but when I get to a point that it's been too many questions, I'll say, Mom, we're drilling down too much right now. This is all I needed,
right?
I just want to hear your thoughts on this one topic. We're not going to go all the way down to the bottom of the well right now.
So, and that makes you a wonderful daughter because you're giving her the feedback. And the best relationships are those where you're able to give each other that feedback. So
do your sons do that?
Yes. Absolutely they do. They give me a lot of feedback all the time. And so I don't know if I can get through this one without laughing. So the fact is that when you can be open with each other and when you can say, okay, so you just brought that up. Do you want my feedback? Or do you just want me to listen? So, or you're telling me a story right now and I'm listening to that story and I'm very interested in the story. Would you like me to continue listening or would you like me to offer some feedback? Sometimes they don't want feedback or a question or advice. And I know for myself, I have been in all of those shoes. I have been someone who shares the situation because I want to share it. I have shared because I want feedback. I've shared because I want advice. I have often said, do you think I handled that okay? Do you think I should have done something differently? When I want that kind of feedback, I ask for it. But not everyone does, and not everyone asks for it in that way.
Do you think, has this happened to you that you offered advice because you were fearful? And so instead of letting the child play it out without your advice, you kind of jumped into the situation?
Yes. Yeah, it's that fear. When you overstep your bounds, know that you're coming from a place of fear. When you make the decision without asking the other person, in this case the adult child, whether they want to hear what you have to say, then you're operating from a place of fear. No question about it. Now, there are some people who will say to me, but I've lived longer. I know the answer because I've tried all those other things.
I've got life experiences.
I've got life experiences that they don't have. Mm-hmm. I have found, especially now in this world that we're living in, that sometimes the newer approach is the right approach. Just because we've tried other approaches in the past, that doesn't mean that those are the ones that need to work now. Mm-hmm. So we need to be open to their approach. And we need to be open to their set of parameters, circumstances, people around them, thoughts that they're having about the situation. It's not necessarily appropriate to do it the way we did it.
You know, that's really good, but how do you know that? How do you know the new parameters? If you've always done things the same way, maybe you haven't gotten the same results, or maybe you have. So how can you change what you're doing?
Well, what I'm saying is that the adult child probably has a different way of doing it. And they came about that in a number of different ways that we weren't privy to. So they got the answer on the internet, mm-hmm. or they're using social media, or they're who knows how they came to the resolutions that they did. But the point is that our framework is not the same as theirs. And so who's to say that we really do have the answer? And oftentimes there is no one answer.
I agree with that. Yeah.
So they're coming to it from a different place. And also what concerns them is different. So in other words, we may want to jump in with the answer because we're very concerned about this issue, when in fact they may not be. They want to ride it out, or they don't want to fix it right now. We all have different ideas about when it's time to move, when it's time to act.
You know what I'm curious about too then? So maybe that initial question or advice really isn't even the core of the subject that needs to be dealt with.
Exactly.
It might just be the surface level stuff.
Exactly. But I do want to point out some of the questions that we might ask. So one thing we said was, do you want my advice? Or do you want feedback? Or do you just want me to listen? Those are questions you can ask. Another way of giving advice without giving it is to say, do you think you might want to fill in the blank? So in other words, you're not saying you should do this. You're offering something that they may not have thought of, but you could say, do you think you might want to try? So for instance, I can tell you that the times when I've used that sentence is when it comes to parenting. So for instance, their baby is not feeling well, and I've experienced that same thing when the adult child was a baby, and I may say something like, do you think you might want to try such and such? Or do you think you might want to check in with your doctor about that? So in other words, I'm not saying, well, you should give them such and such, or you should take them to the doctor.
Or if I was you, I would.
Exactly. Yeah. It's giving them the respect of hearing the question. Do you think you might want to consider? And that is a way of offering respect. So initially what we were saying was, don't allow them to think and to assume that you believe they can't handle it. Because oftentimes that's not where it's at for you. That's not why you're giving the advice. And then if you are going to give the advice, offer it in the form of a question with respect. Do you think you might want to try this, or have you thought about that? Rarely do I believe, well, this is the way I did it, works. Okay, now, when they solicit advice from you, they want to know how you did it. So then they might say, here's my problem, what do you think? What do you say? What can you add to this equation? So then it's perfectly acceptable to say, well, this is what I think I might try, or this is what I would do. The absolutes are what we want to kind of eliminate in the conversation. This is what you should do, or this is what you need to do, or those are the kinds of things that we need to keep out of the conversation.
Because there's not always only one answer.
Exactly. Now, I want to move from there for a moment and talk about something else. I want to talk about adult children who are elongating the time when they are in like their teenagerhood. And what I mean by that is when the adult child is in a stage of their life when it's really time to be up and out. It's time to be earning your own living. It's time to be living on your own. It's time to be making your own decisions. And yet they're constantly going back to the nest. They are either still living with the parents in their 30s, or they are still calling the parent, asking questions about every move they make, or they are unsure about their own decisions to the point where they'd rather the parent make the decision for them. All of those situations are unhealthy. And that is not what we want to subscribe to as the parent. So our job then is to help the adult child move into the next stage. And now I will say right off the bat, there are mitigating factors sometimes. Mm-hmm. There are reasons there might be a physical handicap, there might be a mental handicap, there may have been drug abuse. There are times when the adult child is not progressing in a healthy pattern because they've been stymied by things that have happened that have not allowed them to move on to the next stage. But when that's not the case, when in fact they need to be moving on, it's the parent's job to not cradle and not cradle the child, and also make it a situation where they, I'm thinking of the word and I can't think of it, and it's a word like the.
Enabling. Yeah. So when parents find themselves in that, what do they do?
So when you are the enabler, that's when you need to think about, what about my relationship with my child is making me enable this situation? And oftentimes the parent is helping to create that negative situation. And in other words, not allowing the child to move forward. And there are a number of reasons why people do that. Sometimes people are operating out of fear. They're afraid of their own trajectory. So in other words, it's the empty nest time for you and your spouse, or just maybe your single parent, maybe it's the empty nest time for you, and you're afraid. You haven't been without your, you've been raising these kids all these years, and you're kind of afraid moving into this stage. Maybe you don't know what's gonna happen. You're used to talking to your spouse all the time about the kids and about, you know, their lives, and now that's not the case. And so I've counseled many people who have been in that situation where I say to them, what about elongating this child's trajectory is making you do this? Why are you enabling them to still be living at home with you?
I think sometimes it's just wanting to be kind, like, well, I'm just going to let them kind of settle into their life, and you know.
I think sometimes it is, but that's only when it's a period of time, when the parent says, okay, you don't have a job yet, I'm willing to support you for this amount of time. And then I expect you to have a job. And if it's not in your field, I expect you to have any job. But I know that you can be living on your own, and you need to move toward that. That is saying to your child, I got confidence in you. Mm-hmm. I have confidence you can move forward. So what I'm suggesting is there are times when the parents are enablers for their own unhealthy reasons. And so that's when we need to take a look at, why am I constantly giving advice to my child? Why am I allowing the child not to move forward on their own? And that is, so this unhealthiness that we're talking about, that is a step away from giving a piece of advice.
Those aren't easy concepts for a parent to hear, though.
No, it's not. No, it's not at all. Especially when you have an unhealthy situation in your life. So, for instance, I have a client who is a single parent while she was raising her children the entire time. The entire time. When the child left, she turned around, closed the door, and said, "Now, who am I?" And she had to create a life for herself. That's why she came to coaching. The point is, she did create a life. It's a wonderful life. So recognizing that that's your job now. Your job is not to continue to parent the adult child as though they lived with you, as though they're a teenager. If they're no longer in their teens, then you should not be offering unsolicited advice on a regular basis. Absolutely not. Instead, you should be encouraging them to be independent, to make their own decisions, and to live with those decisions. You know, every time our adult child makes a decision, it's not going to work out perfectly. And we only hope that the number of decisions that they make that are not good decisions, are the number of those that are tremendously consequential, we hope that they're not. You know, we hope that those are far and few between.
And making them on their own. My dad always gave us a piece of advice: the decisions you regret most are the ones you let other people make for you.
That's a great saying. That's a great saying, and I believe it. Because one of the things that is part of adulthood and moving on toward adulthood is learning to live with our decisions. Learning to live with the decisions that were not perfect or didn't work out perfectly, and being okay with those. You know, how many kids have gone to a college that they later said, you know, I'm not sure it was the perfect school for me, but I made the best of it and it turned out well. Now, that I don't want to get a lot of letters about how my child is transferring, and that's okay, and don't say that that's not okay. It is okay. But my point is that when you make a decision, the outcome is not necessarily the barometer for whether or not it was a good decision. It's your ability to have lived with the decision that's a better barometer. So like I said, if you make major life decisions that don't turn out well, that makes me sad for you. I'm hoping that that's not the case. But as adult children move through the next stages of their lives, part of the growing and the learning is to be able to make those decisions, live with their decisions, be happy with their decisions, and to know that they made them. That's such a confidence building exercise to, and I want to say allow your children, but it's not even allowing them. It's recognizing they have the right to make their own decisions. And I know for myself, you know, I make a lot of jokes about my children and me and our relationship, and that they do tell me that I can be a Budinsky. But the fact is that what makes me proud of them is who they became, who they chose to become, the decisions that they did make. And they know that too. So that's the other thing that you can do for your children, is not only recognize that they have the right to make their own decisions, not enable them by going to them constantly with your thoughts and your what you would do, but in this instance and in others, not requiring them to continue to rely on you. Mm-hmm. That's about you. And if you are in that situation, if you see yourself doing that, that's a red flag. That if you want that, that's a red flag. The goal is to not want them to keep coming to you with every decision. And so when they do, or every question, when they say to you, "Hey, I got this thing going on, and what would you do?" That's a wonderful thing. Then they want your advice, you give your advice, and at the same time, you, even as you give that advice, you give it knowing that they are capable people, you tell them that you think that, and that they will work it out.
And at some point in time, you're also going to want to help them realize, well, I know you can figure this out. What were your thoughts? You know, what's the way you think you can resolve this before I tell you what I'm thinking?
I love that too.
As a way that we can kind of work through that. So for parents who are hearing this, they're thinking, do I give advice to my adult children? The answer is, well, solicited and unsolicited are very different things.
Absolutely.
Find out if they want it. Find out, and you can be secure in the fact that with them knowing that you telling them, I know you can do this. I'm proud of you, and don't think that I already think you don't know it, right?
Absolutely.
And then what else I got from you was we don't want them, parents, to be enabling the kids so that they're not confident in being able to make those own choices. Because parents or children, any of us, you're going to make some decisions that work, you're going to make some decisions that don't.
Absolutely.
But the most important thing is, I think, that we believe in each other to kind of do the right thing, right?
Absolutely.
Oh, okay.
100%, Rose. You're a great life coach.
Excellent, excellent. Thank you so much, Susan. And you know, if you've got an adult child, Susan has given all the tips and advice that you can to make sure that that relationship is healthy, strong, and wonderful. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time, everybody.